Okay, good morning, everyone. We are going to continue our unstructured grid course, and I would like to point out some important details about our last lecture. So, it was multi-grid. I just want to recall the basis of the multi-grid method, which is when we are trying to find a solution iteratively using iterative solvers. When I said iterative solution, solving all the equations, and in each linear system using an iterative solver for that linear system, we know that our solution contains errors, and those errors are in all the spectrum of errors with large wavelengths and medium and small wavelengths. And then we have seen that the errors can only be reduced with grids which have this the same order of magnitude of the wavelength of the error. And then I don't remember if I made a picture here. And then this is really convinces us of this aspect. Let's say you have an error like that, and then you try to use a fine grid here. I'm going to do a zoom in this part now, which is my solution. And if I'm at the point P here, this is my east and this is my west, this is my P. I'm trying to calculate this point based on that and on that. Of course, they will not go on because they are almost the same. The error, you know, the solution has a large wavelength, and the grid is a lot smaller. Then the method cannot see variations on the variable. You are going to calculate this value based on that will be almost the same because there is no variation. But now it's in the same solution. Now, in the same solution, now you put a grid like that, your P, your E, then of course you have large change, and then the error is eliminated. And of course, if your solution is like that, then if you put grids this size, then you have a large variation between your pressure and the labor and the other one. And then when you are going to calculate this one, you have that one which is a lot different than this one. So the errors rapidly are eliminated. So that's why we need several grids. We need several grids because our solution contains errors of the several wavelengths. This is the base of the multi-grid. And then we were talking about geometric agglomeration, algebraic agglomeration, and we were saying that geometric agglomeration is what you see the grid and you agglomerate in this manner, just looking the geometry and agglomerating the contour volumes. Then we saw that, and then we comment on that, that this is not a physical approach for the agglomeration. And then we can the alternative for agglomerating, and I already draw a boundary layer problem. If this is a fluid flow problem, you have the two alternatives to agglomerate. The geometrics, you just see the grid and you collect Contour volumes. Or it can be like that in the algebraic, because in this direction I have large coefficients, and a grid like that will be suitable for this problem, not that one. So algebraic should be the preferred technique for your multi-grid. And then I brought here some examples of even using Cartesian grids, you can do algebraic agglomeration. Let's see, this is a small one. This white grid has four little ones. So this is the one grid. And then now you are solving an algebraic multigrid method. You are going to agglomerate using the coefficients, and your grid can be like that. I don't remember which problem is this one, but this is just the grids. The grid which resulted based on the agglomeration using the coefficients, the grid two is this one. This is one control volume. This is another one. This is another red one, the green one. And then you agglomerate again. This is one control volume. The neighbor of this control volume is the red one, the black one. And finally, you have three control volumes only in the agglomeration. When you have only three here, then you solve this directly, right? Because you don't need iterative solvers for a grid smaller like that, only three unknowns. And then you come back, you're gonna see now, you come back with the solution, will be a solution this point, in this point, and here in the blue. And then you use these three values of this solution to improve the values in this one, and this one, and this one. And using this solution to improve the value here, and then here. And then when you are here, back here, you have a new value for your variables. Then you can iterate it again in the final grid, which is in the original grid, it's where you want to solve your problem. If for a geometric agglomeration, it will be like that, which is completely different, being algebraic or geometric multigrid. I want just to remember, I'm not going through in detail of those equations, but just to remember how the grid, how the linear system for the second grid and the third one for the coarse grid is created. If you have this solution, if you have this linear system, this is the way we write the central coefficients in the small i is the original grid, or small I and big I. When I change to another two, big I, this one is in the other, in the coarse grid. So this is the linear system to be solved in the original grid. We propose a correction on this solution. Solution is here. Is it possible to see here? Or may I do some? Yeah. Then you say, propose a correction. This is the correction to my original value to have a phi tilde. This solution comes from this variable comes from the solution of this linear system, the one that was iterated until the iterative method stalls, and then I have the solution. I'm going to say, okay, now I'm going to a new grid to find this one, and I will increase the value, the previous value, and I'm going to call this phi tilde. So the phi tilde, if I introduce this phi tilde in my equation, it will give me a residual, because the phi tilde is not the right solution. It will give me a residual. Then just geometrically, I will substitute the phi till by these two here. And this end up in giving me this equation, which is the residual till, which is the solution corrected in the previous grid, in the original grid. And then, what is the key question here in the algebraic multigrid method that we are showing here? Now, you want to force, is this residual be zero in the larger grid, in the second grid? And doing that, you end up with, so this is residual the tilde function, this is residual of this function, and then when I finish to calculate this one, I have this residual. And this one I'm forcing to be zero. What happens is that I just finished to create a linear system similar to that, but now I'm going to find this value, the correction value. So this is the right-hand side term, the central coefficients. The central coefficient for the new system is based on the coefficients for the old one. Then I will have this equation look similar to that, but now I'm solving for phi big I, which is the connected to the phi, which are the neighbors of the phi p of the big I. You solve that now. Linear system to be solved to find this solution here. And then, what's important here, this coefficient, look at that superscript big I, this coefficient is the coefficient in the agglomerated grid. They are calculated based on the coefficients of the previous grid, small I. So you don't need to calculate, to do it. I already mentioned that. You don't need to do balances in the new grid and obtain the linear system. This linear system is obtained completely using the grid, the coefficients from the anterior grid. If it's the original or if it's the second, doesn't matter. The previous grid that was used. And the neighboring coefficients connecting. Let's see, this is the This was my first grid. And I agglomerate like that. I'm using here, there, and they have points there too. This is the I point. And this is the. So there is a connecting coefficient in the larger grid, of course. There is a connecting coefficient with this one, there is a connecting coefficient with this one, there's a connecting coefficient with this one. How do I find these connection coefficients in the coarser grid? They are really calculated using the coefficients for the other grid. So you don't calculate the new grid, it is virtual. Only if you want to draw the grid, you do that. But the grid is virtual, the second one, because you create the linear system, the new linear system, only playing with coefficients from the previous grid. This is the beauty of this method. There is no new grid. You agglomerate with the coefficients. We will comment on that. I just want to extend that, saying that the multigrid can also be used solving simultaneous solution. I'm writing here only in 2D in order to have one less equation to write. But this is the multi-grid method, simultaneous solution. And I'm right in the top when you have only one scalar. And in the bottom here, the corresponding equation. Of course, if I'm solving for phi, if phi is just temperature, by the way, if I'm solving now for u, v, and p, 2D, I choose one v and p, of course the coefficient now is a little matrix here, which multiplies our variable. Our variable before was just phi, now is. So it's just to transform that equation in a simultaneous solution. It's clear here, right? This AP enters your, is an entry in your matrix when you have a scalar phi being calculated. If I don't have just one and three scalars being calculated, let's say U, V, and P, of course this matrix is 3 by 3, if it's 3-dimensional it's 4 by 4, if it's 4-dimensional, if I'm solving velocity and pressure. And this B is the residual, of course, in each cell. This one is, of course, is tilt, is equal, everything is the same. What you do solving one linear system, which is for one scalar variable, you do the same for the simultaneous solution. Exactly the same. You have a residual when it's written for a single equation. I'm just repeating the previous equation and say this is the corresponding equation for a simultaneous solution. So I have a residual in each cell, say a residual of the U variable, V variable, P variable, pressure variable, and P means the node P, the control volume P. It's already here. It would be need to have the P here and here and there, just the residual of U, the V and P, and the control volume. In the control volume you are considering. And these are the, I'm multiplying by these two values. Now they are two vectors. And this matrix is here. It's the P matrix for the I, small I. Is it plus, again, this summation is there. And everything, you know, and this B is right there. So this is the equation. Nothing changed. Just instead of you solving a matrix for phi, just one matrix with entries are in a scalar. Now we are going to solve a matrix with the entries are matrices. So are matrices. Just to finish that, there is lots of summation, but it's the same. It's exactly the same. Then when I have this residual. It's there, residual, you make this zero. Doing this you end up with a linear system. As before, now it's just matrix, the matrix, multiplying the variable, now it's a vector. Summation, matrix, multiplying the neighboring points in the big I, and then you finally have exactly the same, the central coefficient for this cell and all these coefficients, they are found using the coefficients of the previous. So say straightforward, apply it to simultaneous solutions too. And then I'm putting here some brief description. Let's say in a unstructured grid like this one. This is the grid one. It's painted with different colors to recognize the control volume. So how it works, the process. Choose the desired discretization. I already repeated this part several times. You choose the grid you feel suited for your problem. Doesn't matter the size of it. You choose the grid. Let's say it's this one. Then you calculate the first linear system using your iterative solver, and you keep it going until it stalls. And then let's call the solution phi 1, which is the solution in this grid after your iterative solver is no longer working. And then you course the grid. Do like that. You join the grid. This is the most, let's say, most complex part of the additive correction multigrid, because you have to agglomerate your control volumes based on the coefficients. This algorithm is not an easy algorithm to be done, and I can anticipate that. I'm always saying, you agglomerate such that your matrix results with balanced coefficients. But how can I do that if it's a problem with many variables? I have U, V, W, P, temperature, and you are solving all these variables in the same grid. You are going to apply multigrid for every variable, or you are applying the simultaneous multigrid for U, V, W, and P. And then the question is, are you going to create the new grid, the coarse grid, using the coefficients in order to make the matrix with the coefficients isotropic? Then the question is, what coefficients am I going to use? Because I have coefficients for the U equation, I have coefficients for the V equation, I have coefficients for the W V equation, I have coefficients for the pressure equations obtained from the mass conservation, I have coefficients for temperature. What coefficients are we going to choose? That is one important question. Normally, what is done is to agglomerate based on the pressure coefficients, because pressure drives velocities, U component. Pressure drives V component. Pressure drives double V components. So pressure is like a representative of the U, V, W, and P system. So agglomerating according to the pressure coefficients, not U and V, or the equation for U, for V, or for W, but for pressure, you know. But you can, and this is most important coupling too. So this is the root normally. Agglomeration by the coefficients of one important equation that you have in your system. In this case, pressure seems to be the best one. So then you agglomerate with this, there is some of these details in the agglomeration. You agglomerate now, then you end up with a grid like that. But you don't need to say I'm joining, you just agglomerate the coefficients. If you want to draw later on your grid, you can do, but you don't need. Then you agglomerate, then you find a correction. Then you solve the problem here. Let's say you have phi 2. Phi 2 is a correction on phi 1. So phi 1 we installed in the work, and then you correct, then phi 2 corrects the previous solution, which didn't work, no longer work. And then you have a phi 1 corrected. Then phi 1 corrected. Then you could go back to this grid now, because now you have a new values of phi to restart your computation. You can correct, you can find the phi 2 here, correct the phi 1, which was the one that the iterative solver didn't work, find another velocity, another phi, and then you go back here and you iterate again, because now you have a new estimated. It will work a little bit, but the errors of this, of equivalent to the size of this grid, they were already eliminated in the first step. So it's better you go on, you get a new coarse grid. A new coarse grid, agglomerating based on the coefficients. Then you have, let's say, phi 3. Then phi 3 corrects phi 2. And then you can go back. And this is now phi 3 corrects phi 2. And you go back, or you can go to the fourth grid. It depends. Then you choose what you want to do. But there's some, this kind of cycles, we call V cycles. If I start in this grid, I find phi 2 in this grid, I correct the phi 1 which was from there, I have a new value, I can go back there and do the computations. It's easy to understand that I'm starting again here with a new estimate of my values. It will, the iterative solver will work again, but will not, at least not, do the job of eliminating other errors of other wavelength. That's why I have to be here. And then I can do this and this one. I start here and I go there, and then I go back. Then I go back doing that. And what I do when I'm here, listen, I have a value here, there, and there. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 control volumes here. Then what I'm going to do? All these volumes here, which are inside this one, they will be corrected with this value. The control volume which is inside this one will be corrected with the other, because I have 5 values here. One value fits the correction of the control volume which are inside here. This value fits the correction, fits the previous values for the control volume which are inside here. And then I can do that, and then I correct that, and then I go there. And I iterate it again on the grid which I want to solve the problem. But then I eliminate other errors. And I have a new estimative there, and I keep iterating this grid until I get the solution. You know, it's a very easy procedure. There's one thing which is not easy in this method: agglomerate using the coefficients. It's, the algorithm for that is not straightforward. And then you have different possible multigrid. You can start one grid, another grid, then I have no the obligation to come back to the original. I go one step behind, and then I go back again, and then it's called the double V cycles. Or I can do some which I don't recognize, which is a V or a double V, which is called F cycles. F because of flexible. I can go 3 and then 1 and then I can do anything I want, you know. Normally in the solvers, in the commercial softwares, this is not allowed, or this is not open to the user to choose what cycle, how many grids. Normally this is standard there. There's 5 or 4, 3, 4, 5 grids, and the cycle is one cycle which is already as a default in the program, because it would be difficult for the user inside the multigrid trying to choose the how many steps, how many grids we are going to use. It's difficult, so it's better to be fixed in a standard values as the default values. What I already stressed, and I'm going to say it again, is that we are solving one linear system in this case, okay? You are solving the linear system corresponding to your original grid. And then you say, okay, this is my original grid. I went for four grids. I went back to the original grid. I iterated there. I got the residual that I want. I'm satisfied with this solution. Now comes the refining procedure, the grid refining process. Now you will see, now this solution, this very good solution that I already got here, is it a good solution based on the physics of the problem? Then you have to, let's say, refine your grid. Then you say, okay, I'm dividing my grid, I'm putting more control volumes close to more gradients, and then you do everything again, because now your original grid changed it, because you made the refinement of the grid. So don't confuse the multi-grids that you use to reduce the errors with the refining process of your solution. It's clear? It's okay? And now there are some examples. This comes from the results from the CFX data, where they have the solution, fluid flow solution, this curved duct. And you see in the right side, the solution using 25,000 nodes, 100,000 nodes variables, 400,000 variables, and the convergence rate of the solution is the same, independent of the size of your grid. If it's 400, 100,000, or 500,000. So this is very important, which means that when you need to refine your grid and you have to do the multi-grid process several times during your refinement, doesn't matter if you have more, lot of grids or small number of grids, the convergence rate is similar. And this shows the grid refinement, which is relative to the grid nodes. So when you now refine your grid and you use some kind of line solver, some kind of alternated, direct, implicit, some line solver, which you solve line by line. You use conjugate gradient methods for solving your linear system, and here, multi-grid. So the cost is extremely low compared if you use only conjugate gradient or only a line solver. Because I stress again, multi-grid is not a method, a solution method, it's not a solver. It accelerates some base solver which you are using. I don't know really in this solution if the base solver is Gauss-Seidel or if it's conjugate gradient of a line solver, I don't know. But always together with the multi-grid procedure has one iterative solver there. Yeah? And then I have some more pictures which really demonstrated the performance of the algebraic multi-grid method compared with the geometric multi-grid methods. GMG is geometric multi-grid methods. AMG is algebraic multi-grid method. For the same problem, C is the this is the aspect ratio. How the grid is the aspect ratio of the grids, 330 and 300 grid which are and then 300 compared with the aspect rate of the grid, and then the solution are here, the convergence rate, how the solution behaves for different aspect ratio. See, algebraic multigrid method, they are here. 3, 30, 300. And here's the geometric multigrid. Because geometric, it doesn't pay attention to the physics. Of course, it is must be slower in the solution, you know. And so multigrid method, I could say, you cannot survive having a software solving big linear system in which almost 70% of the time of your simulation is solving linear system. You must have a multigrid method in your solver. Now that's compulsory. This is another example. If you solve using Gauss-Seidel, by the way, one problem. I don't know which is the problem. And you use solving multigrid. The CPU time is dramatically different, you know. A multigrid method is a must in your solver. And then there is some remarks here. Reduction of the errors in all levels, in an efficient manner. All levels, I mean, different wavelengths. There is no need to create the coarse grids. They are virtual, because you just create coefficients, right? I think you got it. You have one matrix, then another one, then another system, linear, all based on the coefficient of the original one. So where is the grid? That doesn't matter for me, you know? Since the coefficients for the coarse grid are created using the coefficients of the previous one, previous grid. The method is conservative in all grid levels in accordance with the basic principle of finite volume method. If you get some algebraic multigrid which doesn't pay attention for the conservation, and then you solve in a coarse grid, and then you do some average injecting the values in the smaller grid, so conservation is gone, you know. Algebraic multigrid, especially the method that I show is an algebraic multigrid method, but it is ACM, additive correction multigrid. This is one algebraic. There are several types of algebraic multigrid methods. We are talking about one. Those results are for the ACM, additive multigrid, additive correction multigrid. There is scalable performance. You want to use a parallel computer. It's easily employed in unstructured grids because you don't need to create the grid. Just you agglomerate according to coefficients. But remains the question. Agglomeration is not easy. The anisotropy can be treated with special methods for agglomerating the control volumes. That's what we are saying. If your coefficients are not isotropic, you can agglomerate such that you made the coefficients isotropic. And there is some other slide which tells some comparison between the two. The geometric agglomeration, very, very simplified, of course. There's nothing to do, just to divide. But it's easy also. It's easy when you have Cartesian grids or some other structural grids. Low performance for anisotropic coefficients. If you have the matrix, which is not with isotropic coefficients, is low performance. The base iterative solvers need to be more powerful. So the iterative solver works in the base together with the multigrid is to be more powerful, because the multigrid cannot help sufficiently. Difficult for unstructured grids, yes, because how are you going to create, if you are not based on the coefficients, if you are not, if you are going to create a new equation for a new coarse grid, how do you construct this coarse grid, you know? Algebraic, agglomeration according to the magnitude of the coefficients. Your base solver does need to be powerful. Incomplete LU decomposition is normally used, easily applied for structural grids, and of course, agglomeration roles more complex. And that, then that's what we have for the multi-grid. Since we are working and you are dealing this course with unstructured grids, I would like to spend some time in a special unstructured grid, which are the Voronoi discretization. They are unstructured grids, very, let's say, flexible too. You can have, let's say, square Voronoi diagrams, circular, and you can join the circular with the other one with special Voronoi diagrams in the interface, something like that. And then I'm gonna talk a little bit about this diagram, because Voronoi diagrams, they have one particular and very important problem, characteristic, sorry. The connection between two grid points is in the normal. Let's say you have this single square and you want to generate Voronoi diagrams, will be our control volumes. And then, diagram 6, this is another diagram, center in 2, this is another one in 3, this is another one in 4, this is another one, the 5, and another one, which is the one here. We are just looking to this one, the 1. So, if this is the center of this Voronoi diagram and will be taken as our control volume, and this one is another Voronoi diagram and it will be our control volume, the construction of the Voronoi diagram tells us that the line we joins the neighboring control volume, line 1, 2, is normal to the face of this control volume. So this helps to find derivatives. Let's say the phi dn, which I always have in, we always have in our equation, derivative some scalar with respect to the normal, is easy. It's phi 2 minus phi 1 divided by this distance, because the normal, it's the line which joins. This is unstructured grids with local orthogonality. All the frontiers, the surface of my control volume will always be normal to this face. And the line AB, I'm just reproducing already what's here. The line AB cuts line 1, 2 exactly in the middle. So a derivative, an approximation, let's say phi dn in this point is phi 2 minus phi 1, exactly in the middle. If they were a little bit, let's say, closer to the 1, then you have to take care of the distance between where we are taking derivative with these two points. You know, then Voronoi diagrams have this particularity that they are the normal to the surface where you will have your integration points. Where are our integration points? Here, 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 and there. So it's a control volume similar what we use for the element based, but with the detail that it's normal, the 2 points. This doesn't happen in any other grid unless the grid is orthogonal. But this is a kind of unstructured grid which is orthogonal, locally orthogonal. But of course, it's not easy to generate the grid. No? There's no free lunch, of course, you know. The generation of Voronoi diagrams is not easy for 3D. So there was some previous work in the beginning, people from, I don't know, in Swansea, they were even computing fluid flow, so over a full aircraft, turbines, nacelles, and you know, wings, using Voronoi diagrams. But you don't see too much of that. The normal is to have unstructured grids, hybrids, as we were talking in the element base, join all of them, and there's no orthogonality on the faces of the contour volume. Voronoi diagrams, they are creating a some kind of what they call Delaunay triangulation. If you have a triangle here, see that we have a triangle here. Up to now, what I have explained, I didn't know there was a need to see the triangles. But these triangles means that any point, circle passing on points 1, 2. If you put a circle here, passing in points 1, 2, 3, the center is on B. The center is on B. The center is on B. Any point inside A, B, C, D, E, which is the Voronoi diagram, uses as a contour volume in numerical simulation. If you any point here, you can put a point very close to the point A. This point is closer to 1 than it's than to 2 and 6. This does not happen normally in the integration, in the grid generation, in the discretization. See, by the way, you have a grid like that. You have this grid, this point, let's say, he's in this contour volume, but he's closer to the contour volume of the point of the other contour volume. Voronoi diagrams, they were used in cities in order to divide the city such that a person who lives inside that municipality, even living in the boundary of your municipality, he's closer to the municipality office than the other municipality. Because sometimes you are living somewhere that you need to go far away to get to your service that you need, and the services for the other municipality is closer for you, but you cannot go in this closer to you because you have to go in where you live, you know. And then the Voronoi diagram was used in order to display some organization in where you are going to put some services to attend some population. So where am I going to put the post office? You need to put the post office, let's say, in a position that everyone inside that municipality has a closer post office than the post office from the other municipality, and so on. It's related with this kind of, very used with some intensity in such a kind of organizing services and municipalities, and because any point inside the Voronoi diagram one is closer to point one than two than six and the other Voronoi diagram. The Voronoi diagram would be the regions of a cities, different cities. It can be used for numerical solution too, and because it has such a characteristic of being normal, the face. It doesn't help too much. It doesn't help too much because if you are using the U velocities and V velocities as your coordinate system, as usually done, because you keep the Cartesian velocity as your dependent variables on the problem. So then if I have a Voronoi diagram there, so which is, let's say, normal here to there, I'm calculating things here. And my unknowns are the U velocity and V velocity. It doesn't help. I need the two components there to calculate the mass flow. It would help a lot if my unknown was the normal velocity. Then, of course, if my unknown was the normal velocity, was, let's say, the contravariant velocity component, and then I would have my unknown normal, and then mass flow is the velocity times normal. Would be like a Cartesian if you use the contravariant velocity component. But we have discussed in the other course, in the other part of the course, that using the contravariant velocity components, it looks nice in this case, but there are some other problems in the equation. And this is some examples of what we can do with Voronoi discretization. You can concentrate where you want. See, this is the launch vehicle. It's the profile of the front of the Brazilian launch vehicle. You want to concentrate points where you have the shock, you know. Here is the concentrating on the shock, you know. Here's another type. We have a square with a. See, what you are seeing here is the triangulation. Now with the triangulation, you create the Voronoi diagrams. Here you are seeing only the triangulation, but then you create the Voronoi diagrams with the triangulation. See surface like that one. You have one surface here, another one there, or that one, which is with holes, with solids, and it's flexible. It's flexible. All those problems are not 3D, right? They are 2D surfaces in the space, 3D, like this one and this one. And this one this is just showing the corner here, corner of that. This is true 2D. And those geometries we call 2D and a half, 2.D geometries, because they are 2D geometries in the space, you know. Well, then let's briefly go through Voronoi diagrams. Here's a Voronoi diagram. Here's my contour volume. Here's my point P. Here's my neighboring points. Now, everything is straightforward. If you have just a transient diffusion, only diffusion, then your equation written in vectorial form is the divergence of the flux, and then the integration. Now we have seen this many, many times. So I need to have the divergence of the flux, which is the gradient dot n, scalar n, But then you take the advantage. Now you take advantage because gradient of phi scalar n is the derivative of phi with respect to n, and this is easy. So this is phi nb minus phi p divided by the distance. This distance, LPI. I'm using PI here, I didn't change the PI, it's the same as IP, you know. And then you substitute there and you have a linear system like that, or like, then you solve, it's very easy, diffusion problem using Voronoi grids. Then you can also solve, let's say, a Dvekshor diffusion. And then this is a repetition, I'm really going fast here. I have to calculate that this is the m dot mass flow. I have to have u and v velocity, so I can do nothing in the mass flow because it's locally orthogonal. It's the same as if you do like that. The Voronoi diagrams in this case is if you have a x and y and you have a Cartesian coordinate system. Your discretization here is Cartesian. Does help to be Cartesian if your axis is like that. Because here's the normal, but you need u and v to get the velocity here. So it's the same. No? Now if it's a Dvekshor, it's gonna be a interpolation functions. You are going to do the same, to choose your interpolation function. We talk about that several times. In this problem, I use the weight upstream differential scheme. We just using it's a mixing of diffusion and convection flux. The weight upstream that we already talk about that. Now we introduce the weight upstream. And you have a final equation, which is exactly this. No? Normally, you can use the mass conservation equation to deduce here in order to have coefficients nicely written, and then you get a linear system to be solved. And it's now we saw a pure diffusive advection diffusion, and now you have to say else. I have to calculate the flow. You have to solve the fluid flow. I bring here our previous slide, where the integration of some velocity u here is u I is v u v and double v. This is the integration of our. You have. Do you there? You need to choose everything what we discussed before is the same. And we have the terms. This one, then this is u, this is the contravariant velocity component without metric normalization. This is the gradient of phi, which I have defined the x and defined the y. It's normal, no? And I have the tau and pressure, but everything, all these terms you can easily compute. And if you are using, let's say, a simultaneous solution, you will end up with a simultaneous solution like that. If it's 3D, the final equation will be like that. You introduce the interpolation function for the vector. You introduce the interpolation for the diffuse fluxes, and then you end up with an equation like that. And of course, multigrid for simultaneous solutions applies. You can use the multigrid which just we went through today to solve this problem. So this is what I was my purpose on this course with unstructured grid. So we saw cell center, cell vertex. This is a kind of cell-centered tool, right? Because the Voronoi diagrams and is in the center, is a kind of cell-centered method using Voronoi grids. We saw the interpolation function, we discussed a lot, the mass flow, which gives the information, upstream scheme. So we went through some details of the multi-grid method. So I expect that you are able now to sit down and have an unstructured grids to choose your method and to know what are the steps to go in order to develop your software. On the other hand, also if you don't want to develop your software, I think you are able now to go through in the theory manual of the existing commercial software and see what they are doing there. What is done inside that software with the interpolation function, everything related with unstructured grids, which is really what we use it nowadays.